We went back to Baltimore, and Stella went back briefly to work with Roger Harriet. I was in the haematology department then, and there was some methodology developing for looking at haemoglobin synthesis in the test tube, but it was all very much reliant on getting rabbits or other beasts and injecting them with phenylhydrazine till their red cells were kind of collapsing, and we had this enormous reticulocyte response, and then labeling the cells. But with human beings, of course, to get somebody with 50% reticulocytes is not common. So one had to do a lot of fiddling around with making reticulocyte-rich preparations. But after a while, it worked, and you could label them with leucine, and you could get linear synthesis in the test tube for at least an hour and a half. And while you're looking at linear synthesis, you can feel reasonably assured that you're looking at something close to the real world. But the problem was that to study thalassemia, you really needed to be able to study the synthesis of the individual alpha and beta chains. And there were no methods available for separating them. So initially I went back to my old asymmetrical hybridisation, mm-hmm. just to see. And so you could separate the haemoglobins that way and then look at the labelling. And then another awful method had started to be used. Mainly I had some interaction with MIT, with Vernon Ingram, who'd moved to the States by then, and because Vernon was not in haemoglobin, but he had a very bright research fellow called Lorado Baglioni, who still worked on haemoglobin. And they'd been trying to do some separations with what they call countercurrent distribution. This was a kind of differential solubility, and they had machines to do it, but when I tried to do it, of course, I had to do it. What you did, you put your globin in these different concentrations and then shook like hell, and then looked at the optical density of the supernate. You got something, and I measured them. There was an equal labeling, undoubtedly, but without real quantitation, you're never going to be sure. So this is when chance hit me, really. This was about 1963, at the end of 63, and Mike Naughton rang me up one day and said, there's a young guy called Clegg coming over here. He's in deep trouble. Do you know him? So I said, no. And apparently this John Clegg had been a PhD student in Fred Sanger's lab, and I'd done his PhD on separating fibrinogen chains, and he went over to do a postdoc with Hans Neurath in Seattle, the famous protein chemist. Neurath ran a very Germanic lab. You will be here at 8:30 for a journal club every morning. And you know John, that was not Clegg. I mean, in Cambridge, we didn't do that. We went in when we felt like it, and we went home when we felt like it, and we worked hard, but in our time. So he didn't turn up. And he's only been there about 3 weeks, and he got a note on his desk. Your presence is disturbing the morale of my laboratory. I would like you to go. So here was a young postdoc, penniless, on the west coast of the States, nowhere to go. The only person he knew in America was Naughton. So Naughton got some money, and he came over to this department it was run by a chap called Howard Dintzis, and a very clever guy, appointed very young. It was a new department of biophysics, a lot of talented people. And they put John on an impossible project, actually, which was to try and pulse label. Look at insulin synthesis, basically, put it crudely. And he'd been only there a few weeks, and we started meeting for coffee, and he said to me one morning, this is ridiculous, I'm not going to get anywhere with this. And what are you doing? So I said, well, I'm not getting anywhere either, really, because I'm trying to measure haemoglobin synthesis and I can't get the globin chains apart. So he said, I wonder if that stuff I used in Cambridge, the 8-molar urea mercaptoethanol, might do. So we tried and it worked a dream. It didn't take a couple of weeks, actually. And I had lots of labeled globin from thalassemics. I used to have to go to New York to get the thalassemics, come back on the evening train, incubate their cells. Yeah. But anyway, we had the material. So I decided to do the chain separation over in the haematology department, but we had no equipment. And John didn't have much equipment at the time. So I used to do the chain separations, but had no fraction collector or anything. So I used to have to sit up catching the drops off the end of the tube. And if you look at that First Nature paper on this subject, you find, you know, you usually get nice smooth peaks from chromatography, but they're very bumpy. And those bumps, I think, just represent the fact I dozed off. And so the volume in these tubes is slightly uneven. Anyway, we looked at beta thalassemia, normal people, and alpha thalassemia, and found that what was really happening was that it wasn't so much a defect in hemoglobin synthesis as imbalanced globin synthesis. You made alpha chains apparently at a normal rate in beta thalassemia, and then, of course, they precipitated, and that fitted in very nicely because Fedon Fessas in 63, I think, just a year or so before, had described these big chunks of junk in red cell precursors. Yeah. They called them Fessas bodies for a while. And of course, the question was, what were they? Were they some unstable hemoglobin? And when it turned out that they were alpha chains, then the whole thing started to look sensible, and lots of people started doing that kind of thing.